Hey guys, so it's been a while since I uploaded a real video. My computer short-circuited, unfortunately, due to some water damage on the motherboard. But I'm back thanks to my shitty little laptop for the time being, you know, which is alright. You know, I'm not tripping too bad, even though I'm blue screening every couple hours, but you know, it's alright. I've been actually playing on retail for the remainder of my game time since I unsubbed. I heard about this Project 60 event thing that's been going on a couple days ago. It's like a retail event on Moonguard server, role-playing server, where people are playing only to level 60 with no heirlooms, no dungeon finder, random BGs, and then raiding at 60 in a group. So sounds like fun. I decided to give it a shot. But before you guys check my achievement tab on this character and call me out saying I'm a fucking cheater, yeah, I did cheat a bit. I did a couple random dungeons, a couple random BGs, not too many. For the most part, I played by the rules and I didn't use heirlooms, so. I've been playing a tank on Project 60, and with that I felt the need to make my kind of tank guide. Personally, I've seen a lot of guides out there, and most of them are lifeless and boring, telling you all the same cookie cutter shit with stormy music in the background. I'm gonna show you all the little tricks and subtleties that make the difference between a 200 IQ demigod tank and your average normie tank. So before we get into vanilla specific content, let's use some of the footage that I have from the Project 60 event and go over some basic mechanics that are important to tanking successfully. Step 1. Enable enemy nameplates. These are the little health bars above enemy targets. As a tank, it's really important that you mentally take note of each mob that's in combat, understanding which ones you've already used Sunder Armor on and which ones need to be targeted and hit a little. Compartmentalizing this information subconsciously and reacting to each target is important. AoE tanking is hard on a warrior in Classic, especially without gadgets, and I guarantee you, if you haven't done it before, you will freak out on big pulls, losing aggro and mobs running all over the place and people dying. The best advice I can give you for this scenario is remain absolutely calm. Even in panicky scenarios, ping one target at a time and take it slow. Picking the ones off squishy targets first and just slowly, you know, stabilizing the scenario. In conjunction with the use of nameplates, you want to use a mixture of tab targeting if it's obvious the target's isolated right in front of you, or very, very crucial, very important, is getting used to clicking nameplates reactively with your mouse. So using your mouse to click nameplates is a way better way to target isolated mobs when tanking a ton of mobs. So one target will peel off you, one out of maybe, let's say, 7, 8, 10 mobs, and it'll run off to the mage, let's say, who got aggro. You simply click the nameplate, taunt it back on you, or similarly, you can use charges in the same effect to totems or creatures, pets, whatever. The next thing I want to talk about is mobility and spatial awareness. Spatial awareness is the most important skill for a tank. Understanding the geometry of the layout around you and using it to your advantage. Whether it's tanking a mob in a corner for X reason, or kiting mobs up a ramp and jumping off in order to kite and stall for damage. Symbiotic to understanding the layout is mobility, and using mobility effects in conjunction with slows and strong kiting to avoid hits. 90% of tanks have a complex where they just stand in one spot tanking shit. This drives me crazy. Even when the tank's taking unhealable damage, they just stand there spamming 1, 2, 3 and subsequently die without even putting up a real fight. An intuitive tank will strafe kite to break auto attack timers, cut corners, slow enemies or ask for slows and from his teammates and kite with the slows, you know, giving a couple strikes and shouts as he runs. In order to kite effectively, you need a strafe kite, as you see I'm doing here. Let's go over that really quick. In order to strafe kite properly, you'll want to move like this. If you hold down right click on your mouse, you can spin your camera around. Then if you rekeybind your A and D to strafe left and strafe right, and instead of turn left and turn right, you can mix strafing with the camera spin function to strafe kite. Essentially moving backwards full speed while casting abilities on targets that are chasing you. This is important because if you turn your back to mobs, they hit you on your back. You can't dodge, parry, or block from behind. Strafe kiting is super important as a tank. Another thing you're going to want to do is go to your camera options and select never adjust camera. This is going to allow you to look around and spin your camera without it resetting to its initial position while moving and tanking and doing things. So you can react to what's going on behind you if your healer ass pulls or aggros. Now that we got that out of the way, let's head into the nitty gritty of tanking in vanilla. I know a lot of you people probably already knew some of the information that I just covered, but a lot of people don't. And without that information, everything else that I say is irrelevant. See, the thing is, Most guides tell you how to spec, how abilities work, how to stat, what spells to prioritize, but all that information is futile if you don't have the mechanics down pack. That's why people with pre-raid BIS struggle to tank UBRS, while I can tank full UBRS on a half-naked warrior with a level 40 green shield. It's all about the tricks and gadgets. You need to know all the little things. If you don't, your life will suck as a tank. But don't worry, I'm going to tell you all the little secrets to tanking in vanilla. The first key point to remember about classic tanking is you generally don't have much fury. A lot of time, tab targeting through each target and casting individual low-cost abilities on those targets is more effective than trying to dump all your rage casting cleave, like you would in TBC or Wrath of the Lich King. The rule of thumb I like to use is only use cleave when above 70 rage. Otherwise, use Sunder and Revenge while tabbing through, and sometimes Shield Slam if you have about 40-50 rage. The next thing you need to know is buffs like Thorns, Retribution Aura, and Fire Shield, which deal damage per hit you take, generate threat for you, which is interesting, especially since the damage is relatively significant in vanilla scaling. And you can stack many of these buffs on top of each other. Really important to ask your Warlock, Paladin, Druid friends in the group to buff you with these buffs, especially before AoE pulls, seeing as you're lacking in your skill set. On the same note, there's pieces of armor with similar effects stacking with the buffs. Here's a shield and here's a ring. You have the Naggle ring, which is actually relatively easy to get and really awesome. As you see in this clip, where an enemy hits me successfully, they take 2 damage from the shield that I'm wearing. This stacks with all other buffs, shield spike, and all the other buffs respectively. So applying easily over 50 damage per hit to all targets just from these buffs alone. Another thing to note in respect to this, Demo Shout and Battle Shout also produce threat. So you can run with mobs and just spam Demo Shout as you're fighting them, and you'll keep stacking more and more threat on those targets. Two really unique consumables that I like to use alongside all these buffs are Dragon's Breath Chili and Oil of Immolation. Oil of Immolation, as you see in the clip, creates a fire aura around you, ticking for 45 fire damage every 3 seconds for 15 seconds. The unique part of this consumable is that it doesn't share cooldown with any other pot, so you can pop a sprint pot and then pop the fire aura pot, run around gathering mobs while you're taking fire damage to everyone around you and casting Demo Shout. Not to mention, you could pop the Oil of Immolation over and over and over again for an indefinitely long AoE aura. It does not have a cooldown, so you can keep popping the fire aura over and over again. The next thing that I like to synergize with that is Dragon's Breath Chili, which procs off melee attacks and releases a breath of fire in a frontal cone. This is what it looks like. Pretty awesome, right? I know. So you use the oil for the aura and the chili, and it results in something like this, which is one of the most satisfying things to do in vanilla as a tank. It's just awesome. I love like having a macro with it when it's all procking, you know, spamming the macro or something like that. These two consumables are very easy to farm. The Oil of Immolation is 1 Gold Thorn and 1 Fire Bloom, which is a complete joke to farm. This means you should always have this potion on you. The Chili requires 1 Mystery Meat, which is pretty much everywhere, and 1 Flame Sack, which you farm off whelps in many zones. These whelp farm spots are really awesome in vanilla, and I would suggest hitting them up as you're leveling up and grinding a few levels off pure mob killing there. I went to farm some mats for Chili for this video, and I got really lucky with my first kill getting the whelp pet in one of the whelp farm zones. This pet is rare and will sell for good gold. Another reason why this place is an awesome farm. You could also skin while you kill if you have skinning. Something I'll mention really quick, and it's only for tanking single target. The mobs are really, really hard packs when you know you're not going to be tanking enough to survive. It's a Greater Stone Scale potion, and it's something that only lasts 2 minutes. So you have to keep popping it over and over and to keep it on for the whole duration of a fight. But it's a 2000 armor buff, and you'll see this like every tank uses this on Patchwork, for instance. Engineering offers 2 of the best tools for AoE tanking, which makes engineering hard to skip on a tank, to be honest. First is grenades. As you see in the clip, where the tank goes in, pops Oil of Immolation for the fire aura that we were talking about earlier, nukes them with a grenade, and then intercepts the off target. This is a good example of how ingenuity and clever use of game mechanics goes a really long way in vanilla when you're tanking. But aside from grenades, probably the best AoE tanking item in the game, this is stacked with everything else mentioned, makes you the most awesome ultimate Porcupine Reflecto cyborg tank known to mankind. It's called Force Reactive Disc. This shield is busted, Every time you block an attack, it sends out sparks that hit all nearby enemies. Let's take a look at this item in action. It's absolutely insane. The only downside, as you can see here, is as it procs, it takes hits on its durability. So it's best to use the shield for a bunch of procs at the start and then take it off and put your other shield on, since you can unequip and equip weapons and shields whenever you want in combat. Alright, so for talents, a generic main tank full mitigation build looks something along the lines of this. This is not the build that you really want to be using during early launch of a new server. This build is the type of build that you're going to run when you're main tanking Nefarian during progress, spamming, you know, stone scale pot after stone scale pot. When you're doing dungeons, I run something along the lines of this, but you can run any variation you want. This is really rough and there could be some mistakes along, I just did it really fast. But what's important here is the utility talents. Piercing Howl and the Fury Tree so you can AoE slow mobs hitting you and break auto attack timers. Very, very crucial for tanking dungeons when you're very under geared. This is how I tank UBRS with the Warrior and Greens, as I mentioned earlier. Improved Revenge is a 45% chance to stun on Revenge, which means every second Revenge essentially is going to be stunning. Improved Taunt, so you're not caught on CD when you need it as much. And improved Sunder, so you can tab Sunder spam as much as you can, you know. Here's an example of a type of CC that you can pull on one target as a prot warrior with a build like this. You know, the beauty of it is that Piercing Howl actually slows all targets, so you can imagine what I'm doing right now here on this warrior just scaled up with multiple targets, slowing all of them and, you know, stunning one, stunning the other, kiting around, you know, effectively, you know. Once you get a hang of this, like, you're always in full control and, you know, your runs will be a lot more smooth. Oh yeah, and download KTM. I've played vanilla for a really long time, and in that time, I've seen so many people either too scared to tank, or people who tank completely incorrectly, which renders them almost ineffective. Many people have a really daunting view of tanking in Classic, and will avoid it like the plague, causing a tank shortage for dungeon finding. That's why it's so hard to find tanks all the time. With the right tools, you can be a top tier tank on your server. Tanks have immense cultural power on vanilla realms. So if you can be the big boss hog tank, expect lots of perks to come with it. This guide should help you attain that goal. Thanks for watching till the end, guys. I really hope you liked the video. Please drop a like, comment, and subscribe to my channel so we can keep building the community further, and I'll see you in the future.